Hello everyone, now let us discuss about substance P.
So substance P was first detected in certain tissue extracts of intestinal smooth muscle by von Euler and Gudum in 1931. It is a 11 amino acid neuropeptide distributed widely in brain, spinal cord, peripheral sensory nerves, enteric nervous system, blood vessels and skin. The two other related decapeptides are neurokinin A and neurokinin B, NKA and NKB. They also have been found to have similar actions, and together they constitute the tachykinin family. Substance P along with neurokinin A and neurokinin B together constitute the tachykinin family. Of all three, substance P is the dominant member. Now coming to the synthesis, all three tachykinins, they are substance P, neurokinin A and neurokinin B, are produced by cleavage of a large peptide, pre-pro-tachykinin, and they serve as neurotransmitters or neuromodulators in the CNS as well as periphery. The substance P is primarily associated with pain and inflammation. Coming to the tachykinin receptors. Tachykinin receptors are of three types. They are NK1, NK2 and NK3. The NK1 receptors has the highest affinity for substance P. And all the tachykinin receptors are G protein coupled receptors and they are coupled to GQ protein. Now coming to the mechanism, the responses of these receptors are mediated by generation of IP3 and mobilization of cytosolic calcium, triggering the smooth muscle contraction, glandular secretion, release of nitric oxide and other messengers, cellular proliferation, production of efferent impulses, etc. Now coming to degradation of substance P. By binding of substance P to NK1 receptors, this also leads to receptor internalization into endosomes, and this is the place where substance P is degraded. Once substance P comes and binds to NK1 receptors, in some cases this also leads to receptor internalization into endosomes where the substance P is degraded. Coming to the roles of substance P, it has peripheral and central actions. The peripheral actions are mainly arteriolar dilation, venoconstriction, salivary and mucus secretions, natriuresis, diuresis, etc. Coming to the central actions, it may affect the mood, behavior, stress response, anxiety, depression management and even nociception. Among the central action, substance P plays a major role in controlling the vomiting. Now coming to the peripheral actions of substance P, as discussed earlier, substance P is a potent arteriolar dilator. It acts on NK1 receptors and that leads to the release of nitric oxide, which relaxes the respective smooth muscle. And similarly, veins are often contracted. Arteriolar dilation is seen and venoconstriction is seen because of the direct action on the smooth muscle. Additionally, intestinal, bronchial and other smooth muscles are rapidly and strongly contracted. Similarly, secretions from salivary glands and intestinal mucosa are increased due to substance P. And when substance P acts on kidneys, it leads to natriuresis and diuresis. And whenever intravenous subcutaneous injection of substance P is given, IV injection is given subcutaneously, it produces red spot, wheal and flare due to local vasodilation. Coming to the role of substance P in vomiting, the CTZ and NTS areas in the brain, they express NK1 receptors along with 5-HT3 and other receptors which respond to nauseous stimuli and coordinate the act of vomiting. The substance P is released in response to tissue injury, especially that due to cancer chemotherapy and radiotherapy. The substance P reaches CTZ, chemoreceptor trigger zone, and NTS, which are not protected by blood-brain barrier, and it participate in triggering nausea and vomiting. And accordingly, the MK1 receptor antagonist, they have a potential anti-emetic property, which is utilized in the cancer chemotherapy. Coming to the role of substance P in pain perception. The substance P is released from primary pain efferents in the dorsal horn of spinal cord, and together with glutamate, it serves to transmit the pain impulses. First, a nausea stimuli is perceived. It leads to the initiation of expression of cytokines. And these cytokines, they induce substance P and NK1 receptors. This leads to induction of cellular proliferation. And by this, we can conclude that substance P has a role in inflammatory response. Coming to the role of substance P in cancer, the substance P and NK1 receptors are richly expressed on certain tumor cells. And SP along with cytokines, induced by it stimulate the growth, proliferation, and angiogenesis in these tumors. Hence, NK1 receptor antagonist may have potential utility in certain cancer. Coming to the NK1 receptor antagonist. As we have discussed earlier, the NK1 receptor antagonists, they have a potential anti-emetic property. Based on this fact, they are employed to treat the chemotherapy-induced nausea and vomiting. So usually the nausea and vomiting associated with emetogenic chemotherapy, it has two components. The first one is acute phase and the next is delayed phase. The acute phase is universally seen in all patients within 24 hours after chemotherapy. But the delayed phase affects only some patients on the days 2 to 5. And an NK1 receptor antagonist, aprepitant, is used for delayed nausea and vomiting. So overall, the NK1 receptor antagonists, they improve the efficacy of standard anti-emetic regimens in patients receiving multiple cycles of chemotherapy. And recently, rolapentant, a highly selective and potent NK1 receptor antagonist, which has exceptionally long plasma half-life, which is 180 hours, was approved by FDA in 2015 for the prevention of chemotherapy-induced delayed emesis. Similarly, netupitant and palonosetron combination. Netupitant is NK1 receptor antagonist along with 5-HT3 antagonist. Palonosetron combination was recently approved in 2016. Coming to the drug, aprepitant. It is selective and high affinity NK1 receptor antagonist that blocks the emetic action of substance P. Coming to the pharmacokinetics, it is well absorbed orally, 95% plasma protein bound. The plasma T-half is 9 to 13 hours and it is metabolized by hepatic CYP3A4. And the clearance is reduced with increase in the dose of aprepitant. And aprepitant is eliminated via bile in stools and urine. Coming to the drug interactions, aprepitant has a potential to interact with other substrates of CYP3A4. Requiring dose adjustment of those drugs like dexamethasone, methylprednisolone, and warfarin. The dose must be reduced by at least 50%. Coming to the indications, oral aprepitant, which is given initially as 125 mg and 80 mg and 80 mg over 3 days of time. On the first day, 125 mg is given. And on the second day, 80 mg. And on the third day, 80 mg. It is combined with standard IV odonsetron plus dexamethasone regimen. And this significantly enhanced the anti-emetic efficacy to protect 90% patients against highly emetogenic cisplatin chemotherapy. And similarly, adjuvant benefit of aprepitant has been also demonstrated in cyclophosphamide-based moderately emetogenic chemotherapy. One more use of aprepitant is single oral dose of 40 mg has been found equally effective as ondansetron in post-operative nausea and vomiting. And the injectable form of aprepitant or the parenteral form, which is fosaprepitant, it is a prodrug and in a dose of 115 mg may be substituted for the first dose of aprepitant at the start of 3-day regimen. Coming to the side effects, the side effects which are contributed by aprepitant are weakness, fatigue, flatulence, and rarely rise in liver enzymes. Contraindications are aprepitant is contraindicated in patients on sisapride or pimozide, in whom life-threatening QT prolongation has been reported. Coming to the marketed formulations, they are Apricap, Apricet, and Empo, which are available in 125 mg one capsule plus 80 mg two capsules kit, because it must be given for 3 days on the first day after 1 hour of chemotherapy. They has to administer 125 mg followed by 80 mg on the second day and additionally 80 mg on the third day. Coming to relapitant, it is a highly selective and potent NK1 receptor antagonist, and it was approved by FDA in 2015 for the prevention of chemotherapy-induced delayed emesis. Coming to the pharmacokinetics, it is orally well absorbed. The peak plasma concentrations are attained after 4 hours, and plasma T-half is exceptionally long, that is 180 hours. And it is metabolized primarily by CYP3A4 to form an active metabolite, which is C4 pyrrolidine hydroxylated rolapitant, whose T-half is 158 hours. And it is eliminated via hepatic or biliary route. Coming to the adverse effects of rolapitant, they are neutropenia, hiccups, decreased appetite, and dizziness. Contraindications are rolapitant is moderate inhibitor of CYP2D6 and paraglycoprotein and BCRP transporters. So the rolapitant is contraindicated along with drugs that are CYP2D6 substrates such as thioridazine or pimozide. So a significant increase in the plasma concentrations of thioridazine may result in QT prolongation and torsades depointus. These are some of the contraindications of rolapitant. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe for further videos on pharmacology and other related pharmaceutical sciences.